to Science Home 5 Minutes With, and today I have the absolute pleasure of interviewing Helen Sharman. Now, if you're not sure who Helen Sharman is, well, you should. She is the first British astronaut. And Helen, thank you so much for joining us today. How are you?
I'm well, thank you, and it's a real pleasure to be with you. Thank you very much for inviting me.
We are so glad to have you. Now, in this interview, we're going to try and stick to 5 questions in 5 minutes, but I know we're going to have a lot to chat about. So if we go over the 5 questions and the 5 minutes, I'm sure no one's going to complain. So I'll crack right on and get into the first question. And the first question is something that I've always wanted to know about the astronaut training program. What part of the intense astronaut training program did you enjoy the most?
I enjoyed it really because I can't pick one bit, so it's a bit of a cop-out of answering the question in a way, but because it's so varied, I love learning languages. Mm-hmm. And I got to learn to speak Russian. I love technology and science, and I got to learn about the spacecraft and the experiments. I like keeping fit and doing the physical training and all of those together. Mm-hmm. All in one job, and living in another country and making new friends, it was just fantastic. So for me, it was the variety rather than one thing.
Yes, oh, excellent. I mean, I know maybe the physical part of it wouldn't be my thing, but definitely would love to learn another language. So the second question, this is a question we get asked a lot in the planetarium, particularly by our school groups, and everyone loves food. So I want to know, what was the food like in space, and was there one particular piece of food that you really missed?
I was on a Russian space station, it was a Mir space station, so all my food was very Russian. And of course it had to be preserved. We had tins of things like fish and tomato sauce, packets of dried soup, dried cabbage soup, beetroot soup, all very Russian, but lovely actually once you've added hot water. A bit like making instant noodles, something like that. It's actually quite tasty. And we had tubes, a bit like toothpaste. And I had to squeeze out the tubes, but it was not toothpaste inside. It was cream cheese with bits of pineapple to make it sweet. That was really nice.
Oh, nice, yes.
Hot chocolate in packets. That was probably my favourite drink, actually. Fruit juice as well. So lots to eat, and it was actually quite tasty. And we could sort of enjoy having fun with our food, you know, passing each other bits of food. You could just sort of throw the bread to each other, and then you don't have to catch it in your hand. You can catch it in your mouth. You
know? Fantastic.
But what did I miss? Probably some real nice English breakfast tea, because I like my tea strong with a bit of milk. And the Russians like their tea black and usually with loads of sugar. Now, I got used to drinking it black. Don't mind black tea, but having it with loads of sugar, not my thing. And on board Soyuz, on the way to the space station, we had 2 days, no hot water. And I was really looking forward to getting some tea when I got to the space station. And when I got to get out the packet of tea, I could see the packet, and inside was a little tea bag, but there was white stuff everywhere inside the packet, and it was sugar.
Oh,
all the tea with so much sugar and so sweet, so I didn't drink any. So that's what I was missing when I was in space, was a nice cup of tea.
Oh, yes. I mean, like, it's the same if you go anywhere on holiday and you don't get good tea. And I can imagine just the restriction of being in space and not getting a nice strong cup of tea. Yeah, that first cup of tea when you came back to Earth again must have been amazing. And so my next question for you is a question as well that I know a lot of people would like to know about space and people venturing up there. Was there anything that frightened you in space?
I think we're scared of the unknown. Mm-hmm. And because my training was really good, I understood what was happening. I knew what I had to do. So there was no unknown to be scared of. So no, I don't think astronauts are scared generally because of that. Yeah, and we knew everybody was supporting us, mission control and all the other teams, to help us to do the job and to come back to Earth safely. So no, we weren't scared.
That's good. I've always heard that, you know, if you ever have a problem, you want an astronaut to help you with it because you're very good at keeping a level head. So that's great to hear that, you know, your training was so good, you were able to remain calm and just get on with the job that needed done. Another question for you is something that I think everyone out there wants to know about. Can you tell us about feeling weightless? Did the novelty of it ever wear off?
It is the most wonderful, natural, relaxing feeling you can imagine. And you forget what it's like to have weight. I mean, right now I am sitting down on a chair, and if I think about it, I can feel the seat below me. Mm-hmm. And in space, I forgot what it's like to sit down, to stand up. You know, you don't go to bed, you just get into your sleeping bag and sort of float inside your sleeping bag. And it is just really relaxing. I mean, of course, inside our bodies, we'll mm-hmm. adapt to feeling weightless. We get this body fluid shift towards our heads, and then eventually our bodies get rid of that extra fluid, and we have a different kind of chemistry going on in our bodies then, because we lose blood volume, we lose calcium from our bones and things. So there's lots of stuff in terms of the adaptation, but it does just feel so nice. And no, the novelty never wears off. You kind of get used to it, but it always feels great to be able to somersault slowly for as long as you want. You know, it's just fantastic.
That just sounds amazing, and I'm a little jealous right now that you got to do that. And then the final question of our five, this one came from one of our faculty, one of our astronomers, and I think it's a question that maybe a lot of astronauts would be asked. So if you could visit any planet, which one would it be and why?
So I'll answer in a very non-astronomical way, I suppose, but not non-astronomy way, because I don't study astronomy. But like everybody, I suppose I have my favourite planets. Mm-hmm. And I've always rather liked Neptune, partly just yes. because it's so far away, mysterious. Because it's so far away, we don't know much about it. But I like blue things, actually. I just mm-hmm. find them quite attractive. And I know Uranus is also a bluish colour, but I like that real gorgeous sort of cobalt kind of blue of Neptune. Of course, we know it's created by the methane in Neptune's atmosphere. And I also always loved that part of Holst's Planist Suites, the last one, of course, Neptune, as it just fades and fades and fades into nothing. So I think all of those things together, yeah, it has to be Neptune.
Excellent. So I hope you don't mind. We've only been on for maybe 4 or so minutes in this interview. Could I ask you a couple of other questions? Excellent. That's brilliant. Thank you so much. So now that we're seeing more things being done, you know, about space exploration, like SpaceX and sending things up, why is space exploration important? You know, what is society gaining from it?
Well, I think there's many aspects, really, and we could talk about how the world, how society uses space now and in the future, what space does for our economy, all the advances in technology, the spin-offs from that, the inspiration it gives people, to young people especially, to think about science and to study engineering, science, medicine in their lives. But actually, I think, you know, there's much more fundamental than that. And I think it's just all about this natural desire to explore, about pushing forward our boundaries. And whether we do that by, you know, how far we can see with bigger and better telescopes, for instance, or whether we do that by pushing forward the boundaries of our knowledge with our understanding of science, or is it actually our physical boundaries about where we go? I think it's all about being, you know, this natural desire to explore, but and we learn about ourselves. We improve lives on Earth, but we also remain part of a species that is looking out and to the future. And that's why space and space exploration is so important.
Oh, I think that is the best answer I've ever heard to that question, Helen. That is just beautiful. Another question I have for you is, did going into space change your perspective on life in any way?
I think certainly when we look back at the Earth and we think about, you know, the people that are living in those countries that we're flying over, it is exactly those individual people that we think about. You know, we don't think about the stuff that we own. Mm-hmm. Our possessions are, you know, it just didn't come into my brain once, but it was those individual people, my family, my friends, and then the individuals in all the teams in mission control, teams working together to support us. But it's those individual relationships that you build up a trust with and that helps you to do the work that we need to do. So it's all of those individual relationships that, for me, it made me realize, I think, how much that the aspect of humanity, human relationships is so important to people, to me. And certainly I changed my life and the way I live my life. I no longer strive to earn more money to buy more stuff.
Yeah,
It's nice to have stuff. I'm not saying that it's wrong to strive to own nice clothes or whatever, but actually, you know, that's not what life's about. Life's about human relationships. That's what makes life meaningful.
Oh, that's beautiful. And I think that answer as well will resonate with everyone in the current situation that we're in as well. Now, this is maybe a bit of a, I don't know if you would call it a cheeky question, but I'm just being really nosy here. I would love to know, how much personal luggage were you allowed to take with you into space? Were you allowed to take any?
Well, we were told originally that I'd have, not in terms of a weight, but I was given a sort of there'd be a bag about kind of this big, you know, so
yeah,
a few kilos. But not long before my space flight, then it was realized that a computer was in need of repair. In fact, we needed to take up a spare computer with us.
Right.
I flew into space in 1991, right? So almost three decades ago, when computers were big, massy things. So my personal luggage got reduced to 180 grams. Can you imagine? I mean, to be fair, all the stuff that I needed was in space. You know, my toothbrush had already been sent ahead. Yeah, so I didn't need to pack things like that. So it's not quite like your suitcase going on holiday.
Yeah.
But it would mean that all those little personal things, I mean, it became a tiny brooch that my father had given me, a little pin that my mum had given me, a comic strip from one of my friends, some photographs, you know, basically just enough to make up this tiny little packet of 180 grams. Yeah, it's worth weighing that if you can.
I'm just gonna go and after this weigh out like 180 grams of flour and see how much that is. That sounds, it's so little, but I suppose you're right, they needed the spare computer, so that had to take priority.
If I had to choose computer or whatever else it was that I was going to take, you know, I'd rather have the computer to keep me safe.
Exactly. And I have one final question for you, and I know that this will mean a lot to everybody. If you had one piece of advice for the kids watching, what would that be?
When I was at school, I thought it was impossible to be an astronaut. Nobody from this country had gone into space, therefore it was never going to happen to me. But you know, the world's changing so quickly and we don't know what's going to happen in the future. There are so many more opportunities now and there will be even more in the future that we can't even dream of just yet. And I think if we continue to study science, engineering, those kind of subjects, so that we can understand more about the world we live in, we will just put ourselves in a position to be able to make use of so many of those opportunities in the future and really enjoy exploring a variety of things which will make our life interesting and as exciting as we want it to be.
Helen, thank you so very much. That answer was absolutely fantastic and it echoes things that we say in the Planetarium all the time. Thank you so much for joining us today. And guys, thank you for joining us for 5 minutes with Helen Sharman. We will hopefully see more of Helen in the future and her future endeavours. And thank you again for joining us and see you later.